Alhamdulillah, Nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nasta'gfiruhu. Wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyati a'malina. Man yahdihillahu fala mudilla lah. Wa man yudlil fala hadiya lah. Wa ashhadu an la ilaha illa Allah wahdahu la sharika lah. وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالًا كثيرًا ونساءً واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن خير الحديث كتاب الله عز وجل وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. Brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brothers and sisters, this evening I wanted to talk a little bit about a topic that I think Shaykh Mu'adh already introduced us to, and that was Ramadan. And I wanted to just talk a little bit about Ramadan and the issue of building community, that how Ramadan helps us to build community. And there are certain factors that are involved. Inshallah, I'll try to discuss each one of them briefly and then try to talk a few practical points that we can do to prepare for Ramadan. As you know, Ramadan is roughly 3 weeks away. And at this point, we are in the month of Sha'ban. Sha'ban is the month right before Ramadan. And you see, in building a community, Ramadan is a time for all of us to reflect and to think about what is the community all about. And how, as we begin to get into Ramadan, we will begin to see that there are various facets of Ramadan that help us to strengthen that community. Brothers and sisters, before we even talk about the various factors, there are a few historical incidents that happen that have a direct influence on how to understand Ramadan. You see, Ramadan became obligatory for us to fast in the month of Ramadan in the second year of Hijrah. In the second year after Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had done the hijrah, after he went from Mecca to Medina. And in the month before Ramadan, in the month of Sha'ban, this is when various historical incidents happen, and it has a direct bearing on how to understand Ramadan. First of all, the fasting of Ramadan itself was mandated in the month of Sha'ban, right before the month of Ramadan. So the order to fast in the month of Ramadan, the order for this came in Sha'ban. the month before. So the Muslims can begin preparing for the month of Ramadan. The whole idea was not to let Ramadan catch you by surprise. So you're not running around on the last day, oh my God, it's Ramadan tonight? Oh no, I have to go to the grocery store, and I have to do this and I have to do that. Oh, and by the way, I'll make it a Taraweeh, but I'll be a little bit late. Don't let Ramadan catch you by surprise. That's the whole point. So Ramadan was mandated in the month of Sha'ban. The second, and all four of these incidents that I'm about to mention happened in the month of Sha'ban, right before the month of Ramadan, where the fasting was made obligatory. So the first issue was the fasting in Ramadan. It was made obligatory in the month of Sha'ban before the month of Ramadan. The second issue was that zakah now became mandatory. It was made mandatory in the month of Sha'ban right before Ramadan came. The third incident that happened was that the Qibla was changed from Bayt al-Maqdis to the Kaaba. Okay? The Qibla of the Muslims was changed from, you know, from Bayt al-Maqdis to the Kaaba. So that's a major development that happened. And the fourth incident the fourth ayah that came down, it mandated the issue of struggling in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even if it meant to fight in the way of Allah. This mandate came in the month of Sha'ban, right before Ramadan. Now, of course, as you know, brothers and sisters, nothing in the Quran is there just by coincidence. This is all planning from, the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all a divine plan, how it happens. And things are in a certain order. All of these issues were there to prepare the Muslims to face the struggle. To face the struggle, the eventual struggle of truth against falsehood. Of what is right and what is wrong. Ramadan was a month for the Muslims to prepare and to start getting ready to face this challenge. This challenge of people trying to put down Islam, trying to quash Islam, being hostile towards Islam, killing the Muslims, assassinating the Muslims, plotting against the Muslims, all of that, the idea was to prepare the Muslim to face that challenge. To face that challenge. So hence, the orders came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to start fasting in the month of Ramadan. The order came to give zakah, you know, to give money in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because as you know, one of the areas that you spend zakat is known as fi sabilillah, in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it is to confront this type of a challenge to protect Islam and to defend Islam. Of course, so that order came, the zakah. The order came also to change the qibla. So the Muslims have their own identity. They have their own qibla. They're not sharing with someone else. They're not following the customs of other people, of other nations, and so on, of other groups of people, the Judeo-Christian world. The Muslims were to have their own identity, and they have their own qibla, to separate them from others, the way of Allah and the way that is not of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or the different ways. The fourth issue that came down was the issue of fighting in the way of Allah if it gets to that stage, to defend the cause of Islam. Fight against, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقَاتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلَّهِ الَّذِينَ يُقَاتِلُونَكُمْ وَلَا تَعْتَدُوا. You know that, and fight those, you know, for the sake of Allah, fight those who fight against you, but do not transgress the bounds. In other words, don't do things that is not from the ethics of war, not from the etiquette of war. Like, don't kill innocent children and women and so on, and elders and religious people and so on and so forth. Many different rules that Islam came to put as when it comes to fighting and so on. So anyway, the issue basically came that these four incidents came to prepare the Muslim to face that challenge. Now, when it came to fasting, there are three major things that fasting helps us to do. The first of those issues is that the Muslim is committed totally to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Muslim, Ramadan, teaches the Muslim to commit himself or herself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to respond immediately to whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has asked him or her to do. So the idea is, brothers and sisters, that Ramadan is supposed to be a test, to test the mettle of the believer. You know, it's very easy for anybody to say, look, I'm a Muslim, I'm a strong Muslim, I don't waver, you know, I'm totally there. You know, I'm a very strong person when it comes to my commitment to Islam. I mean, it's easy to say that, and a lot of people do say that today. Ramadan is a time when the Muslim is tested, and each one learns how true they are to their statements, how genuine they are in their commitments. Each person knows. Because you see, Ramadan is not easy. There are difficulties in Ramadan. You know, being a test as it is, there are various things in Ramadan. For example, we're used to doing things in a certain way. We're accustomed to doing things in a certain way. We have certain habits that we're used to doing. And Ramadan comes and says, look, you have to break those habits for now. If you're used to smoking, or if you're used to watching television at a certain time, or you're used to checking your emails, you know, and see what's in the inbox and so on, at a certain time, you have to break some of those trends. If you're used to eating a lot during the day, then that has to break. This habit has to break in Ramadan. The idea, not only with our habits, but also when it comes to the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You see, Ramadan now is making this thing obligatory, making the fasting obligatory. And as human beings, we don't like things that are obligatory. You know, we want some leeway, we want some loopholes. You know, that's the human being. But Ramadan makes things obligatory. Now you have to fast. No excuses, you have to fast. Unless there's a legitimate excuse, that's a different issue. But in general, you have to fast. It's something that's obligatory. So it's a test to see if we're going to follow this obligation or not. Ramadan, you have to fast for the whole month, 29 or 30 days. It's a commitment. Many people, you know, it's difficult. Many people don't want to keep a commitment that's so long. People are busy, people have other things to do, and so on. Ramadan is not easy. When it comes to Ramadan, we're not just talking about the physical fast. We're talking about the real fast. You know, the real fast, which means that not only do you have to stay away from food and drink, but you also have to stay away from backbiting. Your tongue has to fast. Your ears have to fast. Your tongue has to fast in the sense that you can't curse in Ramadan. It doesn't matter whatever language you curse in. Doesn't matter, it's all haram. It's not just English. Because some people, you know, they say, okay, I'm not cursing, and then they curse in Urdu or Arabic or... One time I was talking to this one brother, and I was telling him that, you know, this is haram, and you know, he spoke Arabic. So he said, but Arabic is the language of the Quran, it's okay. So, backbiting and cursing, these things, of course, and you know, abusing people verbally, like your spouse, all this is haram in the month of Ramadan. Your tongue has to fast. Your ears have to fast. Your ears have to fast from eavesdropping, from listening to things that you're not supposed to listen to, from listening to gossip, listening to music, listening to things that are displeasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, when some people are talking about other people, all of a sudden, you know, everybody's ears perk up and say, oh, yeah, what happened? Your ears have to fast. They don't need to listen to things of that nature. As Rasul ﷺ, he said, دَعْ مَا لَا يَعْنِيكَ. Leave that which does not concern you. Leave that which does not concern you. So your ears have to fast. Your eyes have to fast. Meaning that you should not be looking at things that you're not supposed to look at. Like the opposite gender, or like at people's faults. You know how sometimes when you walk into a room and somebody just undresses you with their eyes? The way that they look at you? You know, your eyes have to fast from doing something of that nature. Or sometimes, you know, you tell somebody, look, don't backbite. Okay, they say, okay, I'm not going to backbite. And then, you know, they don't backbite with their tongue, but then they backbite with their eyes. You know how people's eyes move when they're trying to point a fault in someone? So our eyes have to fast. The real fast, that is. And this is why Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, مَنْ لَمْ يَدَعْ قَوْلَ الزُّورِ وَالْعَمَلَ بِهِ وَالْجَهْلِ فَلَيْسَ لِلَّهِ حَاجَةٌ فِي أَنْ يَتْرُكَ أَنْ يَدَعَ الطَّعَامَ وَشَرَابَ. Whoever does not leave bearing false testimony, you know, saying something that they didn't see, and working according to it, and does not leave acting ignorantly, then Allah has no need for them to leave their food and their drink. The real fast is more than just the physical fast of leaving the food and the drink and the intimacy and so on. Your eyes have to fast, your ears have to fast, your tongue has to fast. Also your hands have to fast. They shouldn't be hitting people. They shouldn't be stealing. Your feet have to fast. Your feet have to fast from going to places that are displeasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your heart has to fast from hypocrisy, from negativity, from holding grudges against people, from suspicion, from shirk, from hypocrisy. All these areas, from hasad, from envy, from hating someone, your heart has to also fast. So Ramadan is not something very easy. But then the whole idea is that in Ramadan now, people may waste their time by doing various things, by talking, by in parties, staying up real late, and forgetting about the Taraweeh and so on. Why? Why do people do that? Because they have not valued Allah the way they should. وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدَرِ. They have not valued Allah like the way they should value Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How they should be, they hold Allah so dear. They don't do that with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And hence, brothers and sisters, the first thing is to respond to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has asked of you despite the hardship. The idea is to respond. And even though you may not understand the wisdom of something, but you respond to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the first thing that Ramadan is to teach us. The second thing is the whole issue of being different. Of being different. You see, when the Qibla was changed, the whole idea was that the Muslims, they have their own identity. We as Muslims do things in a different way. When we fast, we're fasting not just to stay away from the food and the physical things, but that's just part of it. Our fasting involves the entire existence. We're different. The way that we do different things, we're different. Our salah is different. Our commitment to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is done in a different way. We have our own way of doing things. We dress in a different way. We conduct ourselves in a different way. The Muslim is different. He or she has a separate identity. And again, don't misunderstand me here. I'm not saying that we should be isolationist, that we should not deal with other people. No, we are there to deal with other people. We're there to mix with other people, but not to compromise our faith. Not to melt our identity into the melting pot. You know, brothers and sisters, one time I went out with a group of Muslims. We had about four Muslim families. And we went and met with a group of Jewish families. And we went and we had dinner with them. And the whole idea was to get to know each other and so on. They should know about the Muslims, we should know about the Jewish faith and about the Jews and how they do, you know, how they work and so on, the different groups among them and so on. So after we listened to them, they asked us to explain about Islam, and we explained about Islam. A comment that one of the Jews made, he said that, you know, one of the things that we are really amazed about you all as Muslims, is that no matter how much the pressure, that somehow you all can maintain your identity. You live anywhere in the world, but you still maintain your identity. We as Jews have not been able to maintain our identity. We've lost many of our values, many of our customs to the American system. But you as Muslims, we have something to learn from you. That you as Muslims, you participate in the political process, you participate socially, but you don't lose your identity. You maintain your identity. And this is something that is emphasized in Ramadan, brothers and sisters. The third thing is the whole issue of tarbiyah. That Ramadan teaches us how to nurture ourselves to come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So how is that done? How does Ramadan educate us? How does Ramadan teach us? How does Ramadan help us to nurture ourselves to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The first thing, and mind you, remember, all of this is related to building the community. The first thing is to respond to the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To commit yourself totally to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You see, Ramadan, when you fast, nobody knows you're fasting. Like when you make salah, other people see whether you're making the salah or you're going up and down in the motions and so on. People see that if you're making the salah, you're not. But when it comes to fasting, nobody but you and Allah knows that you're fasting. You can fake it. You know, you can basically, you know, you see, when you see people, you can just lie and say, yeah, I'm fasting. And then, you know, you sneak a drink or you sneak, food or whatever. So only you and Allah know if you're really fasting. And that requires commitment. So one of the first lessons of Ramadan is absolute commitment to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's what you need when you want to build community. When you want to bring the Muslims together, you need absolute commitment to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Only in that way can you form a community. You will not form a community through just potluck dinners and through social occasions. Those are just get-to-know sessions. You know, those are just like feel-good sessions. People will know each other and say, MashaAllah, oh really brother, oh you're doing this, oh sister, oh MashaAllah, you're doing this, oh MashaAllah. And then that's it. That's it. There's no commitment to each other. So Ramadan, the first thing it tells you is this total commitment to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as more and more people come together who are totally committed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then the community feeling will grow. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنًا, that it is not up to the believing man or the believing woman. That once Allah and His Messenger have made a ruling, that they have a choice in the matter. In other words, they submit themselves totally. That's what a Muslim means, one who has submitted. So, and not only this, but they have no arguments with whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has asked them to do. They have no arguments at all. You know, فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ. No, by your Lord, they don't believe until they make you an arbiter in their affairs. And then they don't find any discomfort in their hearts. ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا خَضَيْتُ وَيُسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. And they submit totally. They submit totally to Allah's way. So the first thing, if we are going to benefit from Ramadan in building our community, is to commit ourselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To be obedient to the Qur'an and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You cannot have any misgivings at all. You have to have this mentality and this belief that whatever Allah and His Prophet have said, that is the best thing for me. You cannot have any misgivings. Oh, but we're living in the 21st century. Oh, but this is America. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا كَانَ رَبُّكَ نَسِيًّا. Your Lord is not forgetful. Allah didn't forget the fact that you are going to live, that you as a human being are going to live in America in the 21st century. Allah knows that. And yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you the Sharia, the way to apply the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is what you have to be committed to. You can't have any misgivings. So just because the media is saying that, look, oh, you know, Sharia law, you know, and all this stuff, and a lot of the Muslims are beginning to succumb to that and say, no, I don't believe in that stuff. Don't even talk to me about that stuff. I don't believe in that stuff. But they haven't even studied what is Sharia. What does Sharia mean? What is the Islamic law? I mean, it used to be, brothers and sisters, you know, when the Muslims were going into other lands to give da'wah, the Christians and the Jews were inviting the Muslims to come in and implement the Sharia law. Would you believe? This is how it used to be. You know, in Egypt, when the Amr ibn al-As came through, the Coptic Christians, they said, look, we want you to come and implement the Islamic law. We're sick of the Roman law. The Romans were Christians. They said, we want to leave the Roman, Roman auspices, you know, we want to leave from the Roman Empire, and we want to be with you as Muslims. We would rather be with you and underneath you as the Muslim Empire, under the Khilafah. They wanted Islamic law, and so on. Brothers and sisters, so the first thing is the commitment to the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We cannot have any misgivings about any of the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us. Because we know Allah has our best interest in mind. Oh, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has legislated this or has decreed these things because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what's best for us. Knows what's best for us. Okay? Now, number two. Restrain ourselves from the different desires, the shahwat. The different desires, to restrain yourself from those things. The desires that we're talking about is any of these desires that make you feel good, but they take you away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They take you away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So like when you eat or drink, and you go overboard, then obviously it's going to make you sleep more, and you're going to have bad health, and you're not going to be able to do the work of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you're supposed to be doing. If, for example, your desire is to be disloyal to your spouse, again, you're breaking up a family. In that case, and again, I'm not being graphic because again of the issue of children being in the room, in the masjid here. You understand what I mean as adults. So, if you're going to be adulterous in nature, you're following your desires. And Ramadan came to curb those desires. The desire to make money. Have you made enough money to take care of yourself, or you keep on thinking about money at the price of your commitment to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Just because you're trying to make more money, you don't have a chance to come to the masjid. Is it worth it? Ramadan came to curb those desires. It's your desire to be on the internet at all times, to check what's in your inbox, your emails. But have you wondered what's in your spiritual inbox? What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told you from the Qur'an? Have you checked out the messages that are coming through the ayat of the Qur'an? It may be your desire to listen to music. Ramadan is the time to curb that desire and pay more attention to the Qur'an. Why? Because when you begin to curb your desires, you begin to pay attention to your mission in life. And that is to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to establish the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you get involved in your desires, whatever they are, let's say sports, that's a big preoccupation of many people. Spectator sports I'm talking about. I'm not talking about, you know, going to the gym and or running and being physically fit. I'm talking about spectator sports. In about 2-3 months, actually probably in Ramadan, you know, the whole NFL thing is going to start. And a lot of people worship NFL. They worship the NFL. Every Sunday, religiously, people are going to be watching the game. As a matter of fact, some people might even leave Sunday school early because today's the game. And so on. The idea is to curb your desires. You know, you're not going to become a football player by watching football. You're not going to become, you know, a great basketball player by watching basketball. You're not going to become a great wrestler by watching wrestling. You know, you're not going to become a great swimmer by watching the Olympics. But you're going to become great if you actually do those sports. So Ramadan came to curb those desires so you have time to pay attention to the real mission of life. And you're not distracted. It doesn't mean that eating and drinking is haram. It doesn't mean that, you know, being with the opposite gender is haram. But it has to be done in halal ways. That's the thing. It doesn't mean that sports is haram. It simply means that yes, if you're interested in sports, do things to become physically fit so you can serve Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala better. You can become stronger and serve Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But it doesn't mean that you vegetate in front of the television for 10 hours and you're just watching television the whole day. Or when it comes to sleeping, in Ramadan, many people, they go to sleep. It's like they're, you know, the bears, they hibernate, you know, for the whole day. From Fajr till Maghrib, it's like people, they sleep. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't put the Ramadan there so you can now sleep. You remember the Sahaba, they were active on the battlefield in the month of Ramadan. You know, the Battle of Badr was fought in the month of Ramadan. The conquest of Mecca was in Ramadan. And many other occasions, you know, it was in Ramadan. The Muslims are working hard in Ramadan. It was a regular schedule. So that's the second thing. The third thing is to curb or to control your anger. Your anger. Ramadan is a time for you to de-stress. The idea is that to calm down and not to get angry and to control your anger. A major factor in building the community. Brothers and sisters, these days, when Muslims come together, before long there's a disagreement and people get upset at each other because people become sensitive to each other. People cannot take criticism. Often, the way that we criticize, also there's a problem with that. The way that we talk, the way that we accuse someone, the way that we're condescending. Ramadan came to curb all of that and to restrain, have the person restrain their anger. And this is why you find that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam, you know, he said, أَنَا زَعِيمٌ بِبَيْتٍ فِي رَبَضِ الْجَنَّةِ لِمَنْ تَرَكَ الْمِرَاءِ وَإِنْ كَانَ مُحِقًا. He said that I promise a house in the lower echelons of paradise for the one who is involved in an argument, you know, and they're discussing things, but they leave that argument even if they happen to be right. Even if they're right, they leave arguing. They don't get upset. If they can do that, then there's a house in paradise for a person like that. So curbing your anger, big thing. Number four, giving in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the month of Ramadan, you know, is said about Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he was more generous than, you know, this a certain type of wind that comes, you know, to help the plants to to grow more and so on. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was very generous in the month of Ramadan, especially. He was generous in general, but in the month of Ramadan, even more so. Generosity, brothers and sisters, in Ramadan means that not only giving money, but generous with your time, generous with your patience, generous with your kindness, generous with your forgiveness, with your mercy, with your compassion, with your talents. Generosity in all these areas as well. To come and participate in the masjid, to come and start a new program, to come and participate with other people, to build the community. A community can only be built if people are generous in all these different areas, not just with their money, but also with their thoughts, with their time, with their talents, with their manners, generous with all these things. The fifth thing is the issue of unity. Unity, all of us know that we're supposed to be united. But real unity cannot be established unless and until we come together. We come together and we tolerate each other's weaknesses. That's what Ramadan is supposed to help us do when we come together for Taraweeh, when we come together for the various prayers, when we come together to break fast. The idea is that all of us are together and all of us should feel happy about each other. It shouldn't be an issue that we're trying to find fault with each other. Look what that person is wearing, and look, you know, their breath smells, or I wonder if they took a bath today. All that's from shaitan to divide us. The idea is that we're all together as a family. And we're